Well, last Sunday, I made mention that chapters 6, 7, and 8 of Romans really do go together almost as a unit. Now, of course, the entire book of Romans is incredibly designed to build chapter upon chapter upon chapter, but there is something special about these three chapters here, 6, 7, and 8, in their connection to one another. So we've finished chapter 6 now, and reminding ourselves a little bit of what we looked at, God wants us to know certain truths and then live accordingly. Now, I think that those of you who know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, you know that in believing in his death and resurrection as a payment of the sins that you have committed, you recognize that you're accepted by God, you're forgiven by God, and that one day when you leave this earth and your body goes back to the dust, you'll immediately be in the presence of the Lord forever and ever. It's the glorious truth of the gospel. You know, you have eternal life. But it's important to remember that we're not just down here on earth counting off the years, waiting around until a relationship with God can really begin. But the moment we trust Christ, that relationship has begun. And what we need to understand is that when Jesus died on the cross, not only did he pay the penalty for all of our sins so that we can be forgiven, accepted by God, but he did something else that is directly related to our lives here on this earth in these bodies. And that's what we saw in Romans chapter 6, that our old man, and the old man is defined as that person who is under the power, the rule, if you will, of the sin nature. That's the old man. Now, the moment we come to Christ does not mean that we get to jettison the old sin nature. The sin nature is still with us, even as a believer in Jesus Christ. But you see, the old man is not just simply a connection to the sin nature, but it speaks to the sin nature ruling our lives, controlling us, over us, sovereign over us. And what we find out is that when Jesus died on the cross, he killed the old man. Our old man is crucified with Jesus. Now that is the truth. That is the biblical truth, and God wants us to know that truth. But just as with the gospel itself, it's one thing for the truth to be declared. Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. That's true. But that truth has to be reckoned personally, doesn't it? For it to matter. Okay, it's true he died for the sins of the world, but I need to reckon it for myself. He died for my sins. He rose from the dead for me. And now I benefit from that truth. Well, so it is here. And that's what Paul was getting at in chapter 6 that we looked at. The truth is that our old man has been crucified with Christ. And that we are risen with Christ to walk in a newness of life with God, in identifying in his death and resurrection. It's one thing to know it. What we're also told in chapter 6 is we need to reckon it true. We need to personalize it. My old man is crucified. I reckon that true. And then, having reckoned it true, now I go live accordingly. I go live in light of this truth. And that's what chapter 6 is bringing us all together. And that's where we're going in 7 and 8 as well. So now as we move into chapter 7, Paul is going to continue to establish this truth and make this clear to us. And does so in a very interesting way. Paul, through the Spirit of God, in writing these next several verses here, kind of throws us a little bit of a doctrinal curveball, if you will, as we're going to see. But let's jump into verse 1 of chapter 7. He says, "Or do you not know, brethren, for I speak to those who know the law, that the law has dominion over a man as long as he lives? For the woman who has a husband is bound by the law to her husband as long as he lives, but if the husband dies, she is released from the law of her husband. So then if, while her husband lives, she marries another man, she'll be called an adulteress. But if her husband dies, she's free from that law, so that she is no adulteress, though she has married another man." So he starts off verse 1 in a very general way, making the obvious statement that the law of God has that dominion, has that rule over you for your whole life. In other words, it wasn't like God said, okay, the law rules you till you hit the age of 50 or the age of 60. No, the law was for life, obviously. And then, in the next couple of verses, he takes an example that is found in the law, but an example also that speaks to this connection about bound for life. And that example, of course, is in the issue of marriage. Now, we should say, before we go any further, that right here in Romans chapter 7, verse 2 and 3, Paul is not trying to teach on the doctrine of marriage and divorce as a child of God. The Bible's not silent on that issue, of course. But this is not the place to go if you're having questions and discussions about that issue. Now, just like our day today, back when Jesus walked the earth in the first century, there was a lot of debate, controversy, confusion over what is an allowable divorce in God's sight. And again, the Bible is not silent on that issue, but we're not going to bog down into that today. Paul's not trying to bog down into it in his example here in Romans 7. He's just simply speaking of the general understanding, which we all should have no problem recognizing, is that marriage is a connection, husband and wife, until death dissolves it. That's the purpose, the plan of marriage. Really, even a person today getting married who maybe has no Christian beliefs of any sort, and even those people who, as they're getting married, in the back of their mind thinking, well, you know, we're going to give it our best shot, but if it doesn't work out, we can always get a divorce. But the bottom line is, they at least formally are making a commitment. You take this woman? Yeah. You take this man? Yeah. Until death do we part. That's the idea behind it. So that it is commitment until death, but at the same time, death does in fact depart. It dissolves. And so he makes the point that, and this was brought up in Jesus' time as well, that if the woman has a divorce that is not lawful in God's sight, not justified in God's sight, she goes on and marries another guy, well, since God doesn't really acknowledge the divorce is right, it's as if she's in an adulterous relationship. And of course, that's wrong. But if in fact her husband has died, therefore the marriage has ended, she certainly is free to be married to somebody else. That's just the basic principle. Again, we're not trying to teach on all the details and all the issues concerning marriage and divorce, but those are the basic principles. Both that it is a union until death, but also that death does in fact dissolve the union. So now, moving on to verse 4 is where the curveball is thrown our way. "Therefore, my brethren, you also have become dead to the law through the body of Christ, that you may be married to another, to him who was raised from the dead, that we should bear fruit to God." See, now the curveball to me is, as I'm reading along and I kind of see where he's going, I'm thinking, well, you know, the law is dead to me. I'm not connected to the law. Yeah, the law has that dominion over me in my whole life, but the law is dead because Christ has set me free, hallelujah, and all that. And then I read actually what God's word says. It's like, wait a minute. That's not what it says. I'm dead. I have become dead to the law. That means the law is still alive. Which, of course, is true. God's law remains upon the whole earth. Now, one thing we should say about God's law so that we're clear. When we speak of God's law, so often, again, we're talking of what we call the law of Moses. You know, what God gave to the nation of Israel at the birth of the nation of Israel so that they would be governed by God directly through the law. You see, God's plan for the nation of Israel at their founding was that they wouldn't have an earthly king like all the other nations. They would be ruled by God, a true theocracy. And so God in the law had all the different punishments and things set up so that that would be the way the nation was supposed to be governed. Now, because that is the truth, when we really get into the law, we realize that there's some things there that pertain specifically to the fact that this was to govern their nation and are not really issues about morality, about absolute rights and wrongs. For example, God divided the promised land among the different tribes, and his intention was for the land to stay in those tribes. Well, what happens then if I need to sell my property? You know, what do I do there? And so God set up in the law, and you can read about it, these different things. Well, if you sell your land, you're really only leasing it for certain years, and there's this whole year of Jubilee thing thrown in there, and all that kind of stuff. It's not really issues of morality and right and wrong, is it? But it was necessary and important for that day. So those aren't really the issues we're talking about here. We also recognize that in the law, there is a large portion we might call the ceremonial law. This is where we talk about the temple and the priests and all those animal sacrifices and all of that, which we realize really was just pointing towards the coming of Jesus, wasn't it? And the New Testament actually goes into great detail. The book of Hebrews, the most clearest example, but other passages as well, that Jesus is really the fulfillment of that. You know, he's our great high priest. He made the one sacrifice for sin and so forth. We are the temple of God today. And all of that is explained through the New Testament lens. So we realize that that part also is not really issues per se of right and wrong and morality and righteousness. But with those two understandings, we also recognize that much of the law, and certainly when we look at the Ten Commandments, we see God's standards of right and wrong laid out that apply to all people throughout all time, throughout the world. Now, we might note that of the Ten Commandments, one of those is about keeping the Sabbath, which was specifically given to the nation of Israel, and we could put that one aside. But when we look at the other commands, even as Christians, when we read the New Testament, we're not supposed to steal. We're not supposed to bear false witness, murder, commit adultery, commit idolatry, all these kind of things. So that remains. So here he's saying, we're the ones who are dead. The law is still there. We're the ones who are dead. And how are we dead? It says through the body of Christ. Now here the idea of body of Christ is Jesus' literal body. That which was crucified, which was nailed to the cross. Sometimes the body of Christ, of course, is referring to the church as a whole. All the Christians were the body of Christ. But no, he's saying because Jesus died, because he was crucified, we too have now died as well to the law. It goes with what he was saying in chapter 6. And because this union to the law, which is for life, has now been separated by death, there is freedom to have a new marriage. But this is another little twist, because it's like, well, wait a minute. If I'm the one that is dead, how can I marry anybody? I'm the one that's dead. But you know what? Not only are you dead, you're also alive because you are risen with Jesus Christ. And that's exactly what he says. So that you may be married to another, to him who was raised from the dead. And so that's how it all comes together. In our identification with Jesus' death and resurrection, these are our results. And so now, death has legitimately separated the union we had with the law. And where there is death and that separation, there is now freedom for a new marriage. And that's what's taken place. We are now married to Jesus Christ. And don't we read that throughout the New Testament? We are the bride of Christ. And even the last part of this verse is still keeping the marriage idea together. He says that we should bear fruit to God. See, what is one of the most foundational purposes of the institution of marriage? Not the only one, but a foundational purpose of marriage is the reproduction and raising of children in a society. God puts that within the institution of marriage, doesn't he? A man and a woman committed to each other till death do they part, reproducing, having children, raising those children to become adults in society as well, who will go on and get married and have children of their own and so forth. You remember the very first marriage of Adam and Eve. God brought them together. He told them to go have children. How did he describe it? Be fruitful and multiply. And so I think that the connection is also there. So now we're married. Obviously, we're not talking about any procreation of children, but we still should bear fruit to God. Through this marriage, through this union we have with Jesus as his bride, he's the groom, we should bear fruit to God. Now we go to verse 5. The contrast, for when we were in the flesh. Now again, the sin nature we still have. But we've already talked about the old man being ruled by the sin nature. He's put to death. So when you see an expression in the flesh, that's again a reference to the idea of being ruled by the flesh. Not just simply the idea of the sin nature, the flesh, but being ruled by it, being controlled by it. When we were in the flesh, the sinful passions which were aroused by the law were at work in our members to bear fruit to death. We saw this at the end of chapter 6 as well. This whole idea of when you were in the flesh, when you were living for sin, he asked the question, what fruit did you have back then? And again, the idea is nothing of value to God. Sin pays its wages. We talked about the wages of sin, the paycheck that we get for living in the flesh. But that's not bringing fruit to God. It's just death. And he's going to talk a little bit more. We'll get into it next week here as we get into chapter 7 about how the law does stir up the sinful nature within me and those passions. Like, oh, wait a minute, I'm not supposed to do that? Ooh, I want to do it all the more. But we'll get more into that next time. But now, in verse 6, the contrast. But now, we have been delivered from the law, having died to what we were held by. Repeating what he said. So, it's not that the law died. We died, and so we're delivered from it. We were held by it. We were bound by it. But nope, we're set free. So that we should serve in the newness of the Spirit, and not in the oldness of the letter. So now we can serve in the newness of the Holy Spirit. What a tragedy it is to think that the Christian life is somehow just simply a transition. On the one hand, you say, well, here's God's law, and boy, am I a sinner, and I need a Savior, and all the rest of it, and I realize by looking at God's law that I am that sinner, and I can't keep His law, and Jesus saved me, all right, I am saved, hallelujah, and now I'm a Christian, and here's God's law, and here's how you need to live, and here's how you have to go. It isn't that the thought that so often we have? Well, you're a Christian, here's your do's and don'ts. You're a Christian now. This is what you got to do. This is what you can't do. Now, we've already seen, though, lest anyone think that we're going too far out there. Oh, shall we sin so that grace can abound? Everything goes. No, God forbid. And we've gotten into that. But you see, the point is we're still serving God. But in the newness of the Spirit, how tragic it also is that because of a few crazy, extreme excesses and examples out there where people are just acting crazy, and then some guy on the stage says, "This is the work of the Holy Spirit." No, it's not. It's nonsense. It's a circus act. But because people somehow associate the Holy Spirit with that garbage that goes on some stages, some places, that we've got so many churches and pastors that are almost afraid to mention the Holy Spirit to the people for fear that that's going to be the result. That's ridiculous. That's just incredibly wrong. So, you know, the idea like, well, we acknowledge the Holy Spirit, third person of the Trinity, in our statement of faith that you'll find on our website, but we never want to talk about him to the people because, you know, people, they'll go crazy places with it. This is the Christian life. There is no discussion about the Christian life apart from the Holy Spirit. None whatsoever. This is what the Bible is telling us over and over again. In fact, as we're going to see, Paul mentioned this clearly, the Holy Spirit's presence in your life is the proof, the evidence that you're a Christian at all. Because the moment you believe the gospel, the moment you receive Christ, the Holy Spirit seals you. He indwells your life, seals you at that instant, at the moment of salvation. Remember what a first century seal was all about? It was about ownership, wasn't it? Those guys, those kings or leaders, they had those rings, they'd dip them in wax and they'd seal the documents, and you knew who it belonged to, whose name basically was on that. God seals us with His Spirit. He says, I own them, they're mine. And if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you don't belong to God. It's that simple. And you say, well, how do I know I have the Holy Spirit? Do I got to start barking or singing or doing some sort of thing? God's Word tells you that you have the Holy Spirit. If you believe in Christ, you believe in Christ? Yes. Then you have the Holy Spirit in your life. You need no outside authentication. God's Word is what we need. And therefore, now we can serve God. We can bear fruit to God in the Holy Spirit. Now, we're going to stop in Romans there, but we're not done, because now I'd like us to go to Galatians chapter 5. When we talk about this idea of bearing fruit, we recognize that the New Testament has a couple different examples that are described as bearing fruit. For example, making a disciple is the idea of bearing fruit, you know, leading someone to Christ and whatnot. But I think the most significant reference is where we're going to find in Galatians chapter 5. And I think this should be really where our primary focus is in terms of bearing fruit. And so if you're in Galatians 5, we're going to cruise down to verse 22. Now you notice verse 22 begins with the word but. There is a contrast here. He has just spent a few verses talking about the works of the flesh. And we're not going to get into all that today, but recognize that's his contrast. As opposed to the works of the flesh, the works of sin and everything in our flesh, through our sin nature, we read verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. Now think about that. Ponder each of those for a moment and think about the evidence in your life of the fruit of the Spirit as described here in Galatians. So, yeah, it's true. The Bible says, you know, don't get drunk. The sin of drunkenness is there. But it's not just us reading here, you know, the sin of drunkenness, don't get drunk. Then I just want to go out and drink all the more. Because I can't do it. Because that's what our sin nature is all about. But you see the fruit of the Spirit? Well, self-control. I don't desire to go out and lose control. It's the fruit of the Spirit has given me self-control. You got a problem with your temper, your anger, you just blow up on people? Fruit of the Spirit is long-suffering. You'll put up with all those idiots. But you'll love them too. I love you, man. You cut me off, it's all right. But the thing is, it's not an act. I mean, I'm trying to be a little funny there, but it's not an act. It's real. This is the supernatural working of God in and then out of our lives. The power of God. This is the Holy Spirit in action. The fruit of the Spirit is God's love, God's joy, peace, long-suffering. These are from God. They're not just amped up human emotions. This is a supernatural work of God. The love of God, the love that Jesus showed when as they're driving the nails through his skin, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they do. Say, who can imagine such love? That's the love of God. And that love will flow from our life as fruit of the Spirit, as well as everything else here. And so the Christian life is not just, here's my new list of do's and don'ts. It's about a life filled with the Holy Spirit, and the life filled with the Holy Spirit, against such there is no law. You don't need someone to tell you, don't do that, man. You're a Christian because the God's Spirit is empowering you and you have no desire. You're living life as God intends. This is what it's all about. And so, verse 24, continuing on here in Galatians, and those who are Christ's, you belong to Christ, have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Now again, this is where we're so benefited by the book of Romans, because there's so much detail. He goes into so much depth and elaboration on these truths in Romans that if we just had Galatians 5:24, we might say, man, I got to crucify my flesh. I got to do something here. But no, what we realize is, no, when you belong to Christ, your flesh has been crucified. Jesus did it at the cross, and it's yours the moment you received him. Those who are Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Now, the beautiful thing about the picture of fruit, you know, fruit of the Spirit, you know, you can imagine, can't you, in your mind, how fruit begins to grow and develop and mature. There's a process. It takes a little time. And there's a little bit of requirement there. For example, I don't care how fruitful the apple tree might be, you get your hatchet and you chop down a big old branch and throw it on the ground, how many apples is that branch that you just cut off going to produce? Right? None. And you go back to what Jesus said. He said, he's the vine. We're the branches. We need to abide in him. Just as a branch cannot bring forth fruit except it abide in the vine, the same is true for us. That's why when he said, apart from me, you can do nothing. And then he went on to say that the father is the one who's there as the husbandman. You know, he takes care of the watering. He's going to trim the branches so it bears more fruit. We realize if you're growing anything that's fruit related or whatever, there's got to be someone there to make sure it's watered and, you know, fertilized or whatever and all the rest of it. You got to take care of it for the fruit to develop. There's got to be some. Well, that's God at work in our lives. And as we abide in Christ, the fruit is the natural development, the natural result of that branch abiding in the vine. And that's what is going to happen in our lives. Not because I obeyed the list today. It's because I'm abiding in Christ. I don't need the list. The list is there. The commands are there. And if I'm ever wondering, is God's Spirit leading me to do this? I got to check it out with the Word of God, because He's never going to lead me in a way contrary to the Word of God and its teachings. But God's supernatural working in your life is the change. And then the fruit develops. And so what Paul said in Romans, now that we are alive in Christ, married, joined in union to Christ, just as Jesus, using a different illustration, talked about the union, we're the branch, He's the vine, we're in union to develop fruit, so we can now serve God. But do you see how completely inferior the thought that serving God then is what we might do when we show up on the property on Sunday to help out a little bit? You know, well, I filled out my service application, I've been approved, and now I'm working security, or I'm working in the children's ministry, or the, you know. I'm not saying that that's not an act of service to God, but if that's the closed limitation of our mind, boy, are we off, aren't we? How tragic it is when someone says, man, I can't serve God today. I got to hang out with my wife and kids. We got some stuff going on. What? I'd love to serve God with you, brother, but I got to go to work. What? Our life is a life of service to God. Part of that may be, yes, a tangible outworking there in the local church body there, Sunday morning or midweek or whatever, but that is not what serving God with our lives as Christians is all about. Not what we read in Romans 7 today, is it? We are raised, we're married to Him who was raised from the dead, that we should bear fruit to God so that we can serve in the newness of the Spirit. It's a life. A life that is now for the first time properly lived. Because we're in union with God. You see how different it is than just thinking that the gospel is just all about what happens after we die. Oh, what happens after we die is pretty important, and we praise the Lord for saving us from our sins and giving us that eternal life and that heavenly home that we're going to all go to one day. But God seeks our lives here, in the now, in the present. We're not just killing hours waiting for the grave. We're alive. We're in union. We're married to the Lord. And so, in the power of the Spirit of God, the supernatural outworking power of God, we go forth. And we live our lives. And that's when we are true witnesses of Jesus Christ.